Mrs. Sudhamati Subramanian was working as a senior architect at Okra Architects, one of Bangalore's leading architectural design firms. She's also worked on projects ranging from residential, commercial to hospitality. She has then worked as an assistant professor in the Department of Architecture in Thyagarajar College of Engineering, Madurai. Mrs. Sudhamati Subramanian is currently a freelance architect in Chennai.
Hello, welcome to the UGC video lecture series. Today we are seeing about History of Architecture and Culture 2, Unit 2, Buddhist Architecture, Lecture 1. The contents of the following lecture are Evolution of Buddhism, its origin and how it evolved in various phases, Hinayana and Mahayana Buddhism, Hellenic and Indian interaction, evolution of various building typologies. They are stambas, stupas, viharas and chaitya halls. Let us start by seeing how Buddhism evolved and originated. Before understanding the Buddhist architecture, it is important to know Buddhism as a religion and also a philosophy. Buddhism was not only a religion, it actually began more as a philosophy and a way of life. Why is it important to understand the Buddhist philosophy in order to understand architecture? Because any architecture reflects the lifestyle and the beliefs and culture of a particular sect of people. So, the Buddhist architecture reflects the philosophy and the religious principle that is adopted in Buddhism, which is why we will see the various philosophies of Buddhism through which we will understand the architectural style better. So, Buddhism originated mainly because of this one man called Siddhartha Gautama. He was responsible for the origin of Buddhism. This came into being roughly around the 5th century. As mentioned in our previous lecture, during the decline of the Vedic civilization, due to the very strict class system that existed in the society, there was a need to question the existing class system, especially the ruling class. So, as a counter to those class system, different schools of thoughts and philosophy came into existence. And one of the most important of them was Buddhism. The base of Buddhism actually questioned the idea of God and having a mediator between God and man. So, Buddhism actually questioned the need of the particular mediator that existed between God and man. According to Buddhism, the soul of the human mind, the soul itself was a metaphysical form of God. So, Buddhism insisted that God existed within the human himself. If you say the Buddhist philosophy and thought, it consists of four noble truths and eightfold path. So, they suggest the four noble truths as the following. Life is suffering, the cause of suffering is desire, the cure for suffering is to remove the desire, and to remove the desire, one has to follow the eightfold path. And what is the eightfold path? Right understanding, right thought, right speech, right action, right livelihood, right effort, right mindfulness, right concentration. So, this is the basic underlying philosophy with which Buddhism started its base. As you can see, the philosophies and the principles of Buddhism is very simple, which is also reflected in their architectural style. Buddhism encourages oneself to look within himself, to look within a person. Again, this can be implemented in the more physical form that is in the built form, which is again a result as an architectural style. So it is always important to understand the beliefs and faith that exists in a particular culture to understand its architecture better. That is why you have different styles of architecture for various religions. If you take Islam, you have a different style of architecture. If you take Christianity, you have a different type of architecture. Again, Hinduism has a different style of architecture. Why is there a variation between these three styles? Which is again a reflection of the religious beliefs of those religions. So, it is important to understand the underlying concepts and beliefs and philosophies a particular religion preaches. So, how Buddhism originated and spread throughout Asia? As you can see in this map, Buddhism originated in India and slowly it spread through various parts of Asia as far as Japan here to the east and here Indonesia to the southeast. Sri Lanka also was a major country in which Buddhism evolved greatly. But the interesting fact is that though Buddhism originated in India, it flourished in various parts of Asia better than in India. It was mainly due to two reasons. One was that the Muslim invasion happened, and because of which the Buddhism started to decline, and also the advancement of Hinduism. So, it started shadowing Buddhism, and Buddha was in fact considered as one of the Hindu gods, and it was shadowed by the advancement of Hinduism. Which is why, though Buddhism originated in India, it slowly diminished after a period of time, whereas in other parts of Asia, it was flourishing well. To understand Buddhism again, it is important to know the two schools of thought of Buddhism. There are two schools of thoughts. They are the Hinayana and Mahayana Buddhism. Hinayana was the earlier form of Buddhism, and Mahayana form of Buddhism was the one which evolved at a later stage. Hinayana is also known as the lower vehicle or the modest vehicle. It existed between 300 to 100 BC. It is a more modest form of Buddhism in which they considered Buddha more as a human being than a god. They worshipped just the belongings of Buddha rather than the Buddha himself. And Buddhism was in fact considered more as a philosophy rather than a religion. So, this is how Buddhism actually started. It was more as a philosophy rather than a religion. And Buddha was considered one among the common man. He was considered more as a human than a god. Whereas, in the Mahayana form of Buddhism, Mahayana is also called as the greater vehicle. They started worshipping Buddha as a god, and there were statues of Buddha created, and they started worshipping the statue rather than his belongings. And in contrast to the Hinayana school of thought, Buddha was not considered as a human, but as a metaphysical form of the three bodies that they preach, that is, they are called the three kayas, as you can see. It is called the Nirmanakaya or the mind, the Sambhogakaya, the speech, and Dharmakaya, the body. So, Buddha was given a more metaphysical form. He was considered more as a godly person than a common man. So, during this stage of history, one of the most important period of time occurred in the history of Indian architecture. That was the interaction between Greek and Indian architectural styles. So, this happened because, as you can see in this map, Alexander the Great started his invasion from Central Asia and traveled into India. So, during this stage, there was an interaction between the Hellenistic Greece and the Buddhist philosophies. Why is this important? Because even now you can see the direct influences of Greek styles in various inscriptions and carvings that are found in monuments in India. In fact, in a stupa in Sanchi, you can even find inscriptions that are written in Greek. So, this is one of the most interesting and important period in the history of Indian architecture. So, during this period of time, the Greeks actually ruled a part of northern India, and they were known as the Indo-Greeks. But it is also interesting that they didn't want to abolish Buddhism. They in fact protected the Buddhism as a philosophy and a religion. So, during the Greek invasion, the Indo-Greek kings actually protected and patronized Buddhism, and they wanted to develop it further and evolve the Buddhist religion. As you can see in this image, you see a sculpture of Buddha. This is called a protector of Buddha called Vajrapani, but if you see his appearance is very Greek in nature. The sculpture looks very Greek in nature. You can see the direct influences of how Buddhism and Greek interactions would have taken place at that time. Again, in this sculpture, you can see the lifestyle of Greek people being depicted. It's a kind of a Greek banquet taking place with music, wine. You can see people playing musical instruments. You see Indo-Greek people in the sculpture. So, these examples suggest that a very good interaction was existing during that time between the Greeks and the Indians, and also they supported and evolved Buddhism as a religion. Until this point in time of history, Buddha did not have a definite statue, or they did not have an iconic figure to worship. But it is assumed that it was during this period that for the first time Buddha was given a statue. An anthropomorphic representation of Buddha began during this time. Why is it considered that this was the period when the first statue of Buddha was created? Is that if you can see this image, this is one of the very early and ancient statues of Buddha. If you see his robes, the kind of folds that are created in the sculpture, the way his hair is curly, it is all very Greek in nature. If you see the ancient Greek sculptures, Hellenistic sculptures, these are very distinctive characteristic features of Greek sculptures, the way the folds are made in the statues, especially the standing posture of Buddha, suggests that it was probably during this time that the first standing sculpture or statue of Buddha was actually created. During the later stages of the Buddhist evolution, various empires ruled the northern parts of India: Chandragupta Maurya, the Bindusara, and Ashoka Maurya. As you can see in the map, you can see the extent of these empires. They extend as far as southern India. They were a very powerful dynasty. But out of all the kings and empires that ruled, one of the most important kings that contributed to Buddhist architecture was Ashoka Maurya, also known as Ashoka the Great. Till then, Buddhism was not pronounced as a popular or a common religion, but it was during Ashoka's reign that he proclaimed Buddhism as the state religion. It became more common. He started spreading the ideas and philosophies of Buddhism into various parts of the world. he traveled to different places. He established Buddhist stupas, monasteries, and soon Buddhism began to emerge as a very powerful religion in the northern parts of India. So, during this period, that is during Ashoka's reign, when Buddhist architecture started evolving, it was the peak of the evolution of Buddhist architecture. So, in order to understand the various architectural features, we have to see the four main features, that is the stambas or the pillars, stupas, chaityas and the viharas. These are the four main architectural characters of Buddhist architecture. So, now we have slowly moved from how Buddhism as a philosophy evolved and how it transformed itself into a religion and how it started influencing the architecture of the place. Now, let us see what is a stamba. A stamba is also called a pillar. Usually, Indian architecture has this feature as a very common feature. Usually, in all styles of Indian architecture, pillars are a very common feature. Similarly, in Buddhist architecture also, we have the stambas, all the luts. So, what was the characteristic features of a Buddhist pillar? So, there were two types of Buddhist stambas. One was called the Persepolian type and the other the Greco-Roman type. So, the Persepolian type was an octagonal pillar with a bell-shaped capital which supported an animal sculpture. The shaft was highly polished and the base was vase-shaped. On the other hand, the Greco-Roman type of pillar was rectangular with shallow flutes. It was less ornamental in nature and more tall and slender. They were so tall that their height was almost 6 to 8 times the size of the lower diameter. And at the top of the capital, there was just a fluted vase motif. In the picture, you see a Persepolian type of pillar with a bell-shaped capital and a vase base and an animal sculpture on the top. And out of all the pillars that existed during this Buddhist period, one of the most important pillars that existed during the reign of Ashoka was the one that he himself created at Sarnath, called the Ashoka pillar. As you can see in the image, the capital itself very extensively done in the pillar, and the entire pillar itself is more than 15 meters high. This also has the bell shaped capital with an abacus on top, and on top of the abacus you have four lions facing on four cardinal directions. Initially, the lions supported an iron wheel with 24 spokes called the wheels of law. The capital itself is more than 2 meters height. In this picture, you can see an enlarged image of the capital. This is the capital. This is the abacus. It has curved rounded edges with animal sculptures and a wheel in the center. And on top of this, you have the four lions facing on different directions. In this image, you can see the scale of the pillar as compared to the human scale. You can see how massive the pillar was erected. During those days, these pillars were usually erected as a symbol of victory or to commemorate a particular event. Now, we will see about a stupa. What is a stupa? Stupa is nothing but a mound like structure which usually contains the relics or of Buddha, usually belongings of Buddha which Buddhist people worshipped. There is actually a philosophy behind the structure of stupa and how the particular structure of stupa evolved. As you can see in this image, This denotes the cycle of life and death, and the topmost point is the zenith or the peak. So, this circular structure is the basic ideology from which the architectural form of the stupa was derived. So, based on this philosophy, the stupa was constructed as a circular domes kind of a structure with a zenith marked by a peak structure. So, usually this stupa was built with earth and covered with stone or brick. This is an example of a stupa. As you can see, the semicircular mound like structure covered with bricks, staircases leading. So, basically it is circular in plan. You have entrance gateways or toranas leading to the stupa. This is another stupa. We will see the examples in detail in our next lecture. Right now, we are just seeing the overview of what is the various architectural features. Next, we will see what is chaityas. Chaityas or chaitya halls. So, now that Buddha has been given a form or a statue, an iconic figure, the need to worship and a place to worship began to arise. So, when a deity is placed in a structure, there needs a space in which people come and assemble and congregate to worship. So, this was again a principle of Buddhism in which people gathered and worshipped the Buddhist statue. This led to the creation of these halls called the chaitya halls. You see a typical plan of the chaitya hall on your screen. As you can see, this is a small opening through which people enter, which leads into a long rectangular vaulted hall with an apsidal end. You have colonnades on both sides with two aisles and the nave in the center, and has a stupa in the center. The stupa also has space around it for circumlatory passage. These chaitya halls were carved in natural stone. They were usually constructed with stones, and these colonnaded pillars were elaborately intricated with detailings. You can see in the picture a detailed look of the interior of a chaitya hall. This is the long vaulted roof. You notice the roof, which is semicircular in pattern. Again, you can see the influences of Vedic civilization you can see in this Buddhist architecture. The vaulted shaped roof originated during the Vedic civilization, which has now evolved into something like this. But the thing is, now it is constructed with stone. You have colonnades on both ends with the stupa in the center. This is where people gather and worship the stupa. You can see the bell shaped capital and the vase shaped base, animal sculptures on top, a typical Buddhist stamba, and you have the vaulted roof ceiling. Next, we will see about viharas or monasteries. Viharas or monasteries were nothing but the residential places in which Buddhist priests stayed. If you see the plan, the entrance leads to a large hall around which various niches were created for meditation. These niches were carved into the rocks. They were called cells, and there was also a main shrine in which people worship. They also had assembly halls, dining halls. The assembly hall was again surrounded by pillars. Many such examples can be seen in the Ajanta and Ellora caves. we have different styles of viharas that are existing in Ajanta and Ellora caves, which we'll be studying in detail in our next lectures. This is how an interior of vihara looks. These are the various niches in which the Buddhist priests meditate. The walls of the interiors were also adorned with sculptures. They usually represent stories and life of Buddha, his travel, and his various incidents of his life are depicted along the walls of the viharas. These are viharas shown at different levels. As you can see, they are all carved in the rock itself, done in stone. Let's summarize what we saw in this particular lecture. We saw about the origin of Buddhism, the various thoughts and philosophy of Buddhism, how it evolved, the evolution of Buddhism, the two different schools of thoughts of Buddhism, the Hinayana and Mahayana forms of Buddhism. We saw about Hellenic influences in the Indian subcontinent. Then we saw about the evolution of building typologies, the various salient architectural features of stambas, stupas, chaityas, and viharas. These are a few questions that you can expect from this particular lecture. Briefly explain the terms Hinayana and Mahayana Buddhism. Name any four countries in which Buddhism evolved. What is a stupa? Explain the architectural characteristics of a Buddhist chaitya hall. With this, we come to the end of lecture 1 of unit 2, Buddhist architecture. We will see about the examples of various chaitya halls, stupas, and viharas in detail in lecture number 2. Thank you.